Mr. John, right here. I got a mic for you. Nope, right here.
Oh, that's so cool.
There you go.
Why did they go cordless?
Isn't that amazing?
How do they do this? How does the sound get in here?
I know. How does that work? Hello, everybody, and welcome to the Margot and Sarah Show.
Have your dollar bills handy for the strip park. Oh, wait a minute.
That's not it, John.
Oh, that was the other show?
This is my good friend, John Field, from San Diego, California.
My even better friend, Jim Bowers, from Las Vegas, Nevada.
Thrilled to be here today.
And I'd like to now introduce, without any further ado, from Livingston, Montana, Margot, she walks in beauty like the night, Kidder.
Yay! Hello, Margot. And
Sarah, I love my mom in gardening. She didn't wear leather today, but that's all right.
No leather today. No. Too hot for leather. Where's the leather, Sarah?
Oh, please.
Oh, wait a minute.
Turn around.
Hi, guys. Who are you?
That's Aquaman. Aquaman.
Okay. Yeah, that's before they introduced the new heavy metal Aquaman. If you've seen the trailers.
We are thrilled to have you both here today, aren't we?
Yes.
Now, I have to ask a question. I need some hands. Who has seen the new Wonder Woman movie? And how did we like it? Well, fortunately, we have our own two Wonder Women right here. What do you think, John? How wonderful are they?
Well, in the scale of 1 to 10 in wonderfulness, we're obviously about 11, 12 here.
So,
yeah. Plus.
If Sarah knew my affection for her when that movie first came out, she wouldn't allow me within 50 feet of her. So.
That's just bragging.
Sarah and Margot, how are we doing today?
Well, firstly, thank you all for such a wonderful, warm welcome. I don't quite recall how many years ago was it we were here?
You and I were last here in 2001.
With Valerie and Jack. Was Margot here?
No, you came in 2000 with Mark McClure. Then the following year, Jeff East, Jack O'Halloran, Valerie Perrine, and you were here. And that's the last time I was here.
Well, having said that, it's an absolute pleasure to be back.
Thank you.
To see everybody.
And boom.
I'm not booming with you.
You are a bad guy.
What?
But even boom.
Don't you love that authentic accent, by the way, that Sarah?
Oh, okay, anyway.
Hello, Sarah, welcome to... That's the right one.
Can I just say something?
Yes, ma'am.
Nobody talks like that in England.
What?
Except,
nudge, nudge, wink, wink, say them all.
Can do snapshots?
Can I just ask, are you two a double act or something?
Yes.
We're replacing Penn and Teller when they leave Vegas.
Okay.
Yeah.
They had other people, but they settled on us.
Yes.
We can leave then. We're just
no.
Jim told me, don't bring up the accent because I can't do a proper English accent.
No, you can't.
I'm really good at the Australian.
Well, you might get a job on Mary Poppins.
Yeah. Hey, I got a pocket full of kryptonite. She can say what I want.
Hey, Tim, where are the images? Are they showing?
Yeah, they're going now.
They're going now. Well,
we'll describe what they look like.
Sarah and Margot being here together is extra special this month and this year. Does anyone know why? We have a big anniversary this month, this year. Anybody know? What do you think Sarah and Margot were doing together 40 years ago right now?
I think so.
40 years ago, Sarah had finished filming the villain trial scenes with Marlon Brando, Terrence Stamp, and Jack O'Halloran at Shepperton Studios in England for Superman. After she was done, she moved to the Fortress of Solitude set, also at Shepperton Studios, where she met Margot Kidder. Well, the first film...
We started at Shepperton.
Yeah, you started at Shepperton.
That's before you were there.
Oh, you got more nice.
Your first day on the job was filming Superman 2 scenes in the Fortress with Sarah.
Wow.
With her hand around your neck. And you, right here, the following month, you were punching her. Look right there.
Yeah, sure.
Margo, look right there. You're punching her right there.
Yep.
That was 40 years ago this month. So that's a big deal. What do you say?
Yeah.
And they are just as lovely as ever, right? Come on! So yeah, see, here we go. Sarah's got her hand around Margot. I don't know how long he stood there, for hours.
What I do remember is I got into a little bit of trouble from Donna because we got the giggles, the two of us, because we were there for a long while. And I remember he told me to just, you know, stay in the character. So, of course, well, he didn't say it like that. But I can remember, because we were there for ages with me throttling you gently.
I remember when I came back
between the Supermans, I was taking either Prozac or a tranquilizer, and I remember you said, "Boy, you're really normal this time."
That sounds about right. Yeah.
Is that where you two first met? Was on the Shepperton set?
I remember the day, and correct me if I'm wrong, but I think I'd already started work, but I was certainly on the set when Margot arrived to do her, I think, to do your screen test. And you
right.
were, I can remember I was fascinated with the fact that, to my eyes, you were just a little bit bow-legged. And I thought,
That's from horse riding,
yeah,
right,
no,
Margot?
And I thought, wow, they've got themselves a real, you know, a real... You had your cowboy hat and you had your bow legs, and then you pulled it all off and became a bloody great, wonderful Lois Lane.
Well, thank you.
I think it's safe to say that the image that Margot and I presented to the world off stage was about as far removed from our characters. Because as you know me very well, I mean, I'm very fidgety, I'm very annoyed, very clumsy, and Ursa was very still and all of that. And Madam here was just a cowgirl in my eyes, and she became a real lady.
Very fashionable. I became a lady?
Well, okay, that was an exaggeration. I'm being polite, Margot. All right. You were as Lois Lane. You put the skirt on. You got your legs together. Well,
no. In this round,
at least that wasn't in super tight leather with my zipper.
I'll have you know that I think more men fantasize. Are there any children? Yeah. Okay. I'll be a big cow.
I don't see any children. Go for it.
Go ahead. No, really. We'll wait.
All I'm going to say about my costume was that when it came to the actual flying, they hadn't figured out that my costume, as we know, was slit right up the side, and it was slit here and slit there, and there was a lot of, oh dear, because the initial flying harness was quite a big thing.
Right.
And of course, I couldn't wear that, so I had to wear this little, tiny, little, itsy, bitsy, girdly thing.
No underwear, of course.
Oh, no underwear. Well, you know this story. You're just encouraging me to tell the story. So I'll just tell it again. The truth of it is, no, I was unable to wear any underwear, but on the set of when we were flying, when I was throwing the bus across the street in Superman 2, I was mighty cold because we were on the back lot of Pinewood and it was freezing and it was about 3 a.m. and I was so cold because I was wearing no clothes basically, and all they could come up with was a mink-lined bra for me.
Whoa!
It's true, you didn't know hottest tits in the business. Excuse me, parents with children. But really and truly, they gave me a mink line, and so I had wonderful, you know, warm. Oh, I kept it. Oh, yes. It's going to be on eBay next week, don't you?
Margot.
I have some damaging pictures of you I could put on eBay.
Believe me, I'm not so damaging.
Chris and Donner and Dodie Fayette.
Oh, well, yes.
That's all I'm going to say.
Yeah, that's what she needs to say.
I have quite a few, too. I haven't released yet.
Oh. I have to say, this man is a marvel. I'm really such a joy and a delight for us because you are releasing photos that I've never seen.
Me too.
And I kind of dread what's going to come up next because we're getting to the ones now that I'm going, my goodness.
You're going to be nice.
No, I'm going to be nice.
Always.
But it's fascinating all these years later to be seeing, especially the behind the scenes shots. And
and you look the same age.
Yes, he looks exactly the same.
How unfair.
Yeah, I know, it's very unfair. Oh. But if any of you, well, you could not have checked out Cape Wonder on the site, but it is a wonderful thing to be a part of your group and to see these pictures and to remember with such affection the good old days with dear Christopher and Margot and all of us, because they were heady days, weren't they, back in the 70s, my dear?
They were pretty weird.
They were pretty weird. You said it.
There was something they'd do if I had a hangover. Not that I did that much, but I would. They do what the old movie stars used to do. They put my hair in a ponytail and tighten to my face and go. Yeah. And then you'd have a really Lulu of a headache afterwards.
They did that with my because I had long hair and of course was wearing a short cropped wig as Ursa. They did something where they got a contraption around the back of my head and they pulled the eyes up. They stuck something here a little bit to pull everything got taped up. And the marvelous thing is, nobody ever said to me, get your hair cut. There was never a question of me having a short Ursa haircut.
Right.
And years later in Hollywood, people kept saying to me, why don't you look like you looked in Superman? So finally I weakened and went and got my hair cut and I looked like a truck driver. It was so scary. People would cross over the street and they said,
watching that process is scary because when I was 19, I was on a chat show with Gloria Swanson and Janis Joplin. And Gloria Swanson beforehand, I walked past her dressing room, which there were several helpers pulling her entire face back, putting something else. I mean, and I remember standing there going, I am never going to be an old actress, ever. That's awful. And here we are.
What about Janis Joplin? What about Janis Joplin? She didn't have anything cool. She just kind of...
She was a great... Well, actually, how many kids are there out there? None.
The parents are covering their ears.
I see one.
Here's what happened is... First, Janis came out and sang and answered some questions, and then I came out, and then she came out. Now, Janis had done a sexual act on Dick Cavett right before we came on. And that door was open to that dressing room too. So that was the 60s. And so when Gloria Swanson came on and started, he first said, what are you doing these days? And she said, I'm doing portraits. And he said, oh, you could do me. And she went, no, I could do your head. And Janis goes, and the mics were big things in those days, hung down, and she went, I'll bet you would, baby. And then she just gave this running filthy dialogue through the whole show, and they had to come and take her mic away.
So, if you play your cards right, in a minute they'll be taking your mic away.
I think this is now the perfect time for Can You Read My Mind?
Hit it, John.
Can you read my mind, Margot? No, I'm sorry.
Go ahead.
No, go. I don't know the words.
You know the words.
No, I don't.
Do you know what it is you do to them?
You won't be on the stage again. One more story like that. And I don't know the rest of it.
Oh, you don't know the rest of it. Who would like to ask a question today?
Please raise your hand.
Sarah and Margot.
Oh, Miss Tattoo.
That great bracelet, whatever that is.
How about that Supergirl, ladies and gentlemen? Come on.
Yay!
I was wondering what it was like to work with Christopher Reeve.
Sarah?
For both of you to like work with him.
The first year was horrendous, frankly, because he'd never done a movie. I'd done 10, I think. Everyone else had done movies, but his insecurity manifested itself by him bossing everyone around and telling him how to make the movie. So then he cut takes with me because he needed to know everything was in the right place. And I'd come in like a whirling dervish. Things would be going flying. And so he cut the thing and I go, "Don't you cut anything on me, Chris. Don't you tell me how to act, Christopher." I mean, it just, we had a very, I guess I was Lucy and he was Charlie Brown. That was our real relationship, and it grew into something kind of fun. We played chess together, and he hated to lose, and he often did. He was kind of the first year before he got muscled up and famous, a little nerdy. What would you say?
Well, I've
skinny.
I have always
wore Oxfords with 6 inches between his ankle and the shoe.
I've always described him as being more like, to me, more like Clark Kent than Superman.
Huh.
You know, he was a regular guy. Kind of straight, kind of. Until he grew into Superman.
Yeah.
Not the most.
Then he stayed in character.
He stayed in character the entire time. But it was a long while that before we got there. I remember the very first day on the set with him was the day that Superman went to fly and he lifted his arms up, and of course he had.
This is the best.
Yeah. I mean, Superman does not sweat, does not perspire. And of course, this was one of these tiny little details that they had neglected to think about. So
it happened in every scene.
Of course it did.
And he was scared of the flying.
Yes, I
know. So it happened when he flew. So there was one guy whose whole job was to run around with this battery and a hair dryer.
That's right.
Blow dry his pits between the shots.
He didn't have the guy that's job was to wipe my nose, did he? Bert the snot. I had a guy with a pole, a 40-foot pole with a tissue on the end, because when you're flying all day long.
What were you doing when you got home?
I wasn't doing anything, Margot, but if you're flying and you don't have anywhere to put your tissues and you're flying upside down and your nose is running over the fortress of solitude, which is what happens when you be like that all day long. They had a guy, you know, on the set. The sets, there's so many people are working and everybody's got a name. So you've got, they put the name of your job with your own name. So it's Bill the Paint or Fred Props. And I had Bert the Snot. And his job was to come in with a pole, with a tissue on the end, and he'd get underneath me and he'd do this, and I'd wipe my nose. And then the makeup lady had to come in with a pole, with a little bit of a sponge with a makeup on the end, because of course I had to have thick white makeup because I have freckles, and surprisingly enough, supervillains don't have freckles, you see. So they'd have to cover me with white makeup. So, you know, there were all these little things that used to happen that just to hold things up. And as I said, there was nowhere for me to stick my tissue. Well, no.
I managed to get books down my front when we were flying. Because we were hanging there.
Yeah, it was so boring, wasn't it? You had to find something to do.
Well, this is how I think some of you have heard this story.
They've all heard our stories, but they're just polite.
Here's how, in character, Chris stayed. And we're flying, we're strapped together for 14 hours a day for months. And then Donner took away my, and we were barely speaking at times. We were making each other pissed off. So Donner took my contacts away, so I couldn't smart ass with the crew. So I was stuck with Chris, who's not a really exciting conversationalist. And so I learned a lot of American history through those Gore Vidal books. I kept them down my front, and Chris would go, "Don't you stay in character?" I go, "Chris, I've been Lois Lane for a year, and all we do all week is look left.
Yes, sir.
I can handle it."
speaking of Donner, Richard Donner was honored at the Academy two nights ago for a lifetime achievement. And Margo, you were there?
I didn't get to go. I scratched my eyeball.
Uh-oh.
And got it infected. If anyone has an eye patch, don't drive around. Because you have no depth perception and you have no idea of how you just. I almost got killed several times. It was bad.
Is it better?
Just about, yep.
All right. Well, Sarah recently told a story about sitting in her chair, relaxing as Ursa during the trial filming, and Marlon Brando walking up or coming backstage after filming. And maybe you'd like to tell that story, because I hadn't heard it until recently.
Oh, I've got lots of stories for you, darling.
Please.
Okay. Well, this was really, because one of the exciting things that happened for me quite recently, and I was able to share, was that I found a page of my call sheet, which is the thing we get every day to tell us what time we have to be on set. And I found the day, and it was April 1977.
Correct.
Wow. And it was the first day of shooting with Marlon Brando. And so I was so excited to see this and to remember that, in fact, people are always saying, what was Brando like? And the truth of it was, he really was a superstar. There was something, he had such a charisma, didn't he?
Yeah, I met him before because my then husband, I had a few.
I went through a few with you.
Yeah, you did, actually.
I did, yeah, I couldn't keep up with you.
You stop crying.
Yes, I know, for God's sake, get another one. That's how long we were filming Superman.
We got to know each other well.
We did. Brando.
Brando decided to, in Missouri Breaks was a movie my first husband wrote, and they cast Brando and Arthur Penn. So Brando had said a couple of years earlier he wouldn't do anything that didn't further Native American rights. So he was in a bit of a pickle. So he said to, he said he was going to play Robert E. Lee as, what was his first one? Oh, as an Indian. And Tom tried to point out that was an unlikely name for a Native American. So we were sent down to LA to meet him and to talk him out of playing it as an Indian with his pet huskies playing wolves. And pet wolves, actually. So we go out to his house, and there's these wolves, as we heard about, and out came about a 300-pound guy, grease all over his front, having a war with his Filipino houseboy about making him unlock the fridge, which he told him if he unlocked the fridge, he'd lose his job. And within minutes, you were just in love with him. Just in love with him.
Yeah. I mean, the point of what you were just saying with your story is that you were, I mean, I was completely in awe. I was a 27-year-old English actress. Gene Hackman was like the guy next door, and I just loved him, and we all hung out and we did stuff together. But Marlon Brando was, to me, a superstar. But this is a guy, and that story was, you know, we all have our chairs with our names on the back, and it's a standard procedure on the set that when you go off and film a little bit, shoot something, somebody hops into your chair and relaxes in it. Then the minute you come off the set, they'll jump out of your chair and dust it down, and you know, you sit on down. And I was able to observe Brando coming off the set towards us all, and he noticed that there was a man sitting in his seat. And the guy didn't see him notice, but I saw Brando see him and just take a little bend to the right so that he could just disappear off into the corner, and he got an old can, a tin can, a paint can, and turned it over, and he sat down in the corner quietly on this can so that the guy could remain in the seat and not be embarrassed. And that's, he was a very humble guy. He was lovely.
He was amazing. He was not good to direct or shoot, nervous around him.
Oh, well, of course. I mean, I was nervous around him. And in fact, the first time he sat me, the only time he sat me on his lap, he encouraged me over and he said, come and sit down. And I I remember thinking, do I sit on top of his big fat tummy, which means that my crotch is in his face, or do I sit down? Well, that's the way it would be. It would be this high up, or do I sit on his knees down here? And I was very uncomfortable with the whole idea of sitting on his lap. And he remarked on this. And he said, I'm sure you've sat on many men's laps before. And I said, oh, yes, Mr. Man. And he said, why are you so, he said, everybody's so uncomfortable. I mean, we actually talked about it. He said, everybody's so uncomfortable around me. And he actually, funnily enough, Missouri Breaks, he mentioned it, because we got talking, and I was, again, I was a young actress, and I was very in awe of him, and I did ask him about his technique and the way he looked, and that fabulous look in his eyes when he screwed his eyes up, and he looked so intense, you see? And he said, no, I'm not being intense, he said. I've not got my eyeglasses on, and I'm trying to read the idiot boards over there, and so I'm going, eh. And he said, if you want to check it out, he said, you can see in Missouri Breaks, he'd got the words written on the fence.
All over the fence. That's of right. A garden, Jack Nicholson's garden. Every fence post.
Yeah.
So he can go.
That's right.
And he made some actors wear masks with their eyes cut out with his lines. And the only one who said, no, Mr. Brando, if you're going to be in a scene with me, you learn your lines, was the young lead, the most inexperienced girl there, and he learned his lines.
Oh my lord. Well, I know that I have said that he stuck the lines to my forehead. I think I might have embellished. But he certainly, I had the words written in front of my face. I mean, I know that he read them.
He
didn't stick them to my face. I'm sure he didn't, but it sounds good. What he did tell me, and again, for the young people here, I shall give this I shall gloss over this, but for those that understand what I'm saying, you'll get it. He said, if you think that's bad, Missouri Breaks, he said, in Last Tango in Paris, there was a very romantic scene, if you can call it romantic, where he had with a young actress called Marie Schneider, who was wearing no clothes at all, and he said that as he kissed her affectionately from top to bottom, she said quickly, as he kissed her down the left side, he'd got all the words written down the right side. So he was kissing her and reading them, and he told me that. Told me that, so I have it on good authority. So we got away okay, didn't we, on Superman?
Yeah.
Oh. I wanted to say that this Q&A today is dedicated to the First Lady of Metropolis, Noelle Neal. January 1978 at Pinewood Studios, while Margot and Chris were filming the scenes on your terrace balcony, Noelle decided to visit the set. Do you remember that?
I
just
sure
wonder
do.
If you'd like to share that experience.
I think she'd already shown.
There she is, right there.
Oh, wow. Because she was on the train with her daughter Lois at the very beginning.
Right.
So somebody else
was. Was this the first time you ever had ever met her, though?
I have to tell you, it was the first time I'd ever heard of her.
Yeah.
I didn't know anything about Superman. We didn't have TV where I grew up.
Yeah.
So I knew she was lovely, but I didn't quite get what a big chunk she cut off in her life.
Do you remember meeting her at the Warner Brothers Museum when the DVD came out in 2001?
Yep. Oh, yeah.
That was a great reunion. I remember her saying to me,
oh, I don't know if I should be here.
You know, because she felt like she really wasn't in the movie. And I said, but Noelle, your scene on the train with your line got restored back into the movie. Because as all of you know, it was cut from the theatrical. You just see her, you don't hear her. And she's like, oh, well, okay. But she was so modest about it all.
Yeah, but she was still driving her Harley motorcycle all over the place.
Was she?
Yeah.
She was?
In L.A.
I didn't know she drove a Harley.
Oh, I think it was a Harley. She went on and on about motorcycles. I mean, she was
she did?
Right up into her mid-80s.
I didn't know that. Did you know that, John?
Yeah.
Oh, you knew that.
You're slow, Jim.
Oh, okay. So I learn something new every day.
I was going to say, so you don't know everything, do you?
Nope.
Oh, wow, that's a relief.
I don't know everything. I remember you talking about the ladies' fashions that they had for you for the terrace scene. What was the dress like that they initially gave you to wear?
Well, you know, the English are a bit more eccentric in their clothing than America. And, yeah. And so I had thought, well, if a woman goes to the office, she'd be in a white blouse and a red shirt, maybe, and a jacket. But everything the women designed were really sort of elegant, outre, high, what's the word, fashion. And I kept saying, you know, I don't think this is right. I don't think this is right. Let's take the tail off, you know, stuff like that. And finally, I went to get into my dress for the flying scene, and it was a huge, flowy piece of chiffon with cacti all over it, which was really weird. And it was British. It was a British idea of what an American would wear to a ball. So I said, no cactus. So they had to remake it. They were really pissed off. But the first day I had to wear a suede. Do you remember that green suede dress with leather here and really, really high-end stuff? And I put it on, and then in England they don't make movies all day. They have tea a lot. So in the mid-morning, the tea lady comes through.
Of course, what do you do in America then?
We don't take a break because we work hard.
Okay, isn't it safe to say that some of the finest films come out of the English studio system? So we stop the tea. It's an important part of the day.
They also have with the tea fried egg sandwiches.
Oh,
I
yes.
Never had one of those.
Have you?
No, so I got one. I took a big bite, and the yolk went straight down all over this dress. And so from then on, they made a bib when I ate it. Right around my neck, big pocket. Right here, trying to drop in the pocket.
Well, I can beat you on that one because I got a garbage bag with a cold cut in the top that they stuck over my entire outfit, and they called me Drop the Lot Douglas because I would spill my food too, and it was a nightmare, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah. Sorry, carry on with your design. I'm fascinated by your cactus dress.
Well, there were a lot of designers who wanted stuff on there. A cup reporter doesn't wear green suede. Goes down here, and flaps over. And just fabulous costumes, but not all American. And Superman is all American, red, white, and blue. And in fact, I have a little story I just learned from my best friend, Rosie Schuster, whose uncle was Joey Schuster, who wrote Superman, another Canadian. Just keep you in your places.
Canadian!
And she just found a picture this big, and it's a drawing of Superman, a doodling he was doing, and he didn't have an S on. He had his fraternity at university thing on his chest, and the note on the side says, don't know whether to make his tights red and his pants blue, or his tights blue and his pants red. And it was, isn't that wonderful? Yeah, she could, yeah. I said, Rosie, you could get rich. She went, no.
Give it to us, we'll flog it.
Yeah.
Has everybody seen the Ursa screen tests? They're on the DVD and the Blu-ray, so you need to get it up to speed here.
Yeah,
when you
and,
get home.
And what about me?
You have no screen test.
That's right, and why was that? Smarty pants.
Oh, you're being the smarty pants, you're putting me down.
No. I wouldn't dare put you down because we know what your right hook's like. When I was, when they were testing people for Superman, I was making another great epic, actually one of my favorite pictures I worked on, The People That Time Forgot, which was some cardboard dinosaurs and pterodactyls and the lovely Doug McClure, Patrick Wayne, and it was the only film being shot at that time in England. So I was rather full of my own self-importance because I was working on a film and nobody else in England was working on a film. And so when they came to screen test, they were trying to... Oh yes, and the haircut. You'll notice my hairdo way before. Way before.
Did she get it from you?
Absolutely, I got it first.
You see the hairdo? I don't know if you can make it out, but it looks a lot like Princess Leia.
Yep. But anyway, the point of it was the producers of Superman, because I was working every day on the set, I was at Pinewood, they were at Shepperton, Because I was working every day, I was only available to meet with the producers in the evening, and the producers weren't willing to keep a crew on and spend money in the evening for a screen test. So they tested endless other people, but I never had to do a test because I was there. And they put me through, you know.
That's very English too.
What was that?
Getting drunk instead of me.
Well, not drunk, just merry.
Merry.
Yeah.
But you talked about how Donner would make an appointment with you,
yeah,
and then he wouldn't show up.
Well, that, yes, I had nine separate meetings arranged, and eight times Donner at the last minute, and when I say at the last minute, I mean literally I've been busy all day working on this other picture, I'm getting ready and sort of prepped to go to get in the car, to drive over, to meet with these people, and again, when you say about Superman, I had no idea about Superman. I knew who Superman was, but we didn't, I guess we had him in England, but I don't think
you had the TV series.
I don't know that we did, but I didn't see it, and I was away in the Canary Islands, so I was completely out of the loop with this whole thing. So eight times he cancelled me, and on the eighth occasion I said, that's it, I'm just, you know, I don't need these people, I don't, it was really a bit pissy about it, and the casting director called me up and she said, you know, Sarah, this character is right up your street. Now, I didn't know at the time they were looking for an evil, wicked super bitch, but she said, it's right up your street. She said, you must stick with it, you know, give it another shot. So on the ninth occasion, I got in the car, I drove over to the other studios, I got there, and Donna kept me waiting for about half an hour. And when he finally arrived, and you've also got to, we've got to set the scene in the 70s. He had slightly long silver hair and he'd got blue tinted glasses on. And
now he's short and black.
Now he's short, but then he was a very cool, hip Californian, and I was a very uptight young English lady. And I let him know, who do you think you are? I mean, who do you think you are? Well, I don't think I said this, but I thought it. You come over here with your long hair and your blue tinted glasses and blah, 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 blah. Anyway, I had what is generally described as attitude, and it seemed like I had the right kind of attitude for the first round of the auditions. And he then called me back again, and I was fortunate enough to be working with the stunt people on the people at Time Forgot that were moving on over into Superman. So they knew exactly what was to be expected of me. So they got me well prepared to go into a very small room and do some very high kicks, and basically got Donna up on the filing cabinet in the corner of the room, and Ilya Sulkin cowering in the corner as I whipped around the room with my attitude and my high kicks. And the rest is history. But no, I didn't do a screen test.
No, you didn't.
Thank God.
Unfortunately, we only have 5 minutes left.
Why, where are we going? Well, we just started. We haven't had one question.
We asked for 2 hours. They only gave us 8 minutes.
Well, then we need to talk to the Chamber of Commerce because we've got a lot to say.
I think she's right over there. She's not.
Well, we'll keep going until we get picked up.
Can we get a question?
Yeah. All right, let's get a question from the audience.
Hey, first and foremost.
Holy mackerel, hey,
what have you got between your legs?
Come on over. Come on over.
Can you reach Sarah's mind?
Eyes up here. Ladies.
Is that like a local outfit? Don't you know?
Sometimes.
You wear,
especially on Saturdays. Anyway, ladies, I want to thank you from the bottom of my heart. Growing up, I couldn't think of any stronger, hotter brunettes in my life. And I'm getting nervous because basically I'm talking to people that
I can see you're getting nervous.
Oh my goodness!
Oh, no,
Ursa's making me sweat. Oh my God. No, and they talk about, because seeing you ladies, I'm gonna get real quick to it. Seeing you ladies being the strong women, hot brunette, that people just totally forget that you represented the strong women, especially during that age. And I wanna say thank you so much. And my question is, besides all my gushing, is from the page to what you're showing, how much is that with your own personality and the characters you're portraying?
Well, all I know as far as I went was that because of the makeup the wig that took hours in the morning, my long hair to be, you know, put up into to tight little curls, the white makeup, the sticking, the this, the that, the harness. By the time I, and that was from 6 a.m. or whatever time, by the time I got on the set, I felt...
Hello?
By the time I got on the set, I felt mean. So, I mean, literally, I felt mean. I everything about the day was a challenge. I have to give Terry Stamp full credit. Oh yes, every day was, oh my God, wasn't that wonderful? He was just him. And the things he told me.
All together.
Oh, no. But Terry Stamp was the one that said to me, and in fact, I brought this up with him at the National Film Theatre last year. We had a screening of Donna's Cut, or the 2 years ago. First time I'd seen Terry in years, and I thanked him. It was his idea. He said to me one day, and to Jack, he said, you know, we're from outer space. We're villains. We didn't say we're villains. We're not of this earth. We need to be different. And all we had was our black costumes. We didn't have, like, some super people have all the guns and the this and the that and the stuff. We were just dressed in organza. We weren't even dressed in leather. But he said, we need to move in unison. And he came up with the concept. So when we actually, the three of us moved, there's a fluidity, which you possibly don't notice, but believe you me, I am so fidgety, I notice it. So there we moved together, and it was a wonderful little, tiny little thing.
You can tell more went on than that. Look at her, she's glowing.
Listen.
You know what I know?
Let me tell you, Terrence Stamp, well, I can think of all the different movies that he was in, but I'm just thinking of the one Far From Madding Crowd with that stripe down his leg and on that horse. Oh my Lord, every day was a pleasure to go to work. And he was fresh from India, and had been there for about 8 or 9 years. When we got to that, he'd been in an ashram. That's why he did all that stuff and drinking of mint tea.
A lot of that stuff.
Oh, a lot of that wasn't it?
Once I had a really bad toothache, and he said, I'll give you some medication.
Yeah.
And I thought, ooh, nice.
Yeah. And we were having into medication back then.
And he didn't tell me what niacin did. Oh. Niacin is vitamin B6 or 3. And it gives you that flush. And you get itchy and red. Do you know, anyone out there taking niacin?
Oh, yeah. Did you get itchy and a flush and go,
oh yeah.
Oh, you did? Flush. Oh, well, this is fascinating. So I'm sure you all are interested in it. Okay, go on, itchy, go on.
Well, that was all there was to it, really. It was
that's fascinating, Margot. I'm glad you shared
that. Tricked me.
No,
he tricked me into spending the night up, yes. Scratching and trying to figure out what to do with the red stuff.
Well, but anyway, the point of it is that Terry was, and still, I think, remains very spiritual, but back then, in particular, he had taken, it was either 7 or 9 years away from the movies. So we were very, very lucky. He arrived on Superman, the first film. He was also, had just done or was doing Meetings with a Remarkable Man, which was a very spiritual film as well. Well, as well, it was a spiritual film. So he came along and he got Margot and I and the rest of the package. I think he did very well, don't you?
I'd say so.
I should say so, because the two of us are screeching around the halls of Pinewood. You scratching yourself and me doing God knows what. Anyway, thank you for the question, Mr. Codpiece.
Ladies, I want to thank you so much. You guys are so beautiful and so elegant and lovely. Thank you so much for
thank
wonderful
you.
Memories.
Thank you for coming dressed like that.
How about Aquaman, right?
Yes. I have one question.
Oh yeah, he looks good.
I have one question. Margot, right here. Right here, sweetie.
Oh, you! Oops. I was looking. I thought someone.
I love sister, sister.
Just sisters.
Sisters. I should have said that. What was the accent you had in that particular movie?
The French went out of their minds, as they often do, about me doing the accent wrong. But I didn't. I did a French Canadian accent, which is very different.
It's adorable.
Because I grew up with I was supposed to be Swedish, but I couldn't do that accent. So Brian changed me to whatever I wanted. So I said French Canadian.
I thought it was great. Everybody here seen Sisters before?
So must see, if you're 18 or older, that is.
Yes, that's right.
Oh my gosh!
No,
we got Yellow Zapper out there. Who's that?
Come here, Flash.
Oh, that's Flash.
Sarah and Margot!
Thank you!
standing ovation, please. Standing ovation.
You're not supposed to ask him to stand.
You are. I didn't. Just put my little mouth in.
Yeah.
Who loves Margot and Sarah?